Hey everyone, welcome to the Fantasy Football Fallout. I watch every game every week trying to find you the fantasy football gems, and this episode is all about the Tennessee Titans versus the Atlanta Falcons. All right, everybody. So before we get you prepared for week five, let's talk about what happened in week four. This matchup was interesting. The Tennessee Titans came in, I believe, as slight underdogs against the Atlanta Falcons. It might have been vice versa. Honestly, I don't know. I thought that this is a game, matchup-wise, I've been watching all these games, as I've been saying, that this is a game that Atlanta, in terms of matchup, should be able to win. And by that, I mean, you know, Tennessee is great about stuffing the run. Well, Atlanta and Dirk Cutter, they don't care about establishing the run. I thought that there were going to be openings in the Tennessee Titans secondary. Matt Ryan at home playing against a tough Tennessee team, I think an underrated Tennessee team. I just thought that the Falcons were going to be able to put up a little bit more points than Marcus Mariota was going to be able to lead the team in. Additionally, I thought Atlanta's defense right now, you know, I think their weakness with Neal being out for the season with injury, I thought that they were going to be better against the run and have a little bit of weakness in the passing game that the Titans could not exploit. Well, you know, Titans came in and just whooped some butt. So let's just talk about, first of all, let's talk about Atlanta. I can't figure out what in the world is going on with this team. If you're a Falcons fan, and I think you agree with me. But I will say this. Atlanta, they did have opportunities in the passing game like I thought they would, but Matt Ryan wasn't able to get there. 53 attempts, 35 completions, 397 yards. That all sounds pretty good, right? No interceptions. That sounds great. Matt Ryan's thrown a lot of bad interceptions this year, but no touchdowns. Tennessee did a really nice job, I think, of covering people. But that said, Matt Ryan missed some key throws here and there. And he's been doing that this season. And I said this to my friend. I was in Miami with Brad, the co-host of Get Paid in the Pick Six podcasts. And I said, you know, Matt Ryan to me looks like he's off physically. And if it comes out this season, like after the season, that Matt Ryan had like a labrum issue or some kind of rotator cuff issue and he goes in for a little treatment or a surgery, don't be surprised, because look, I've seen Matt Ryan throughout his whole career. He has a really nice arm. It just doesn't look as strong, and he's in his physical prime. He shouldn't be degrading. It's weird. I don't even think it's a decisiveness issue. Maybe there's a little lack of familiarity with what this scheme is doing. Okay, but Matt Ryan physically looks off to me, and that I think is the most troubling thing at this point. Even if he does have receivers, you know, he's not going to be able to throw a bullet pass in there like he might have been even last season. It's just bizarre. I would say optically it looks a little similar to me like Peyton Manning between his second to last season and his last season. It's just like he didn't have it anymore. But like I said, physically that shouldn't be the case with Ryan. Physically he should be in the prime of his career. I just think something's off. I don't know what it is, but I'm watching the games and he's just not as comfortable, and he's not delivering the balls that he used to deliver back when he's younger. I think as a Falcons fan, you have to be a little concerned this year. Unfortunately, given the status of the coaching staff and given the way the season is going, this is probably a clean house situation in Atlanta. They have a ton of talent on this offense, so I don't think it's going to be a rebuild, but they need some new energy in there, and we're going to see what's going to happen. From the passing game, let's just stick with the passing game here. Austin Hooper, I've been talking about him for weeks. He continues to do well. I am, by the way, so far this season, 4-for-4, predicting whether or not Hooper will get in the end zone. Let's see if I can make it 5 this week. Check out the Atlanta Falcons preview, assuming they're playing. I don't think they're on bye week. But 9 receptions on 11 targets, 130 yards. The dude has great hands. He is the one, I think, consistent outside of maybe Julio Jones, who's just incredibly, you know, he's just a monster every single week. I do think Austin Hooper is probably the most consistent guy. And as I remind everybody, remember, this is the offensive system with Dirk Cutter that had Tony Gonzalez in Atlanta the first go around. He had OJ Howard and Cameron Brate in Tampa Bay. He likes throwing to tight ends. Austin Hooper is a talented tight end. He will be a factor all season long. I promise you that. Julio Jones, only 4 receptions and 7 targets. Credit Tennessee with bottling him up. Calvin Ridley, 6 targets, 3 receptions. Atlanta just couldn't get the passing game going against this defense, this really, really tough defense for Tennessee. We've seen what they can do against the run, and now we've seen what they can do against a pass-first offense. I'm very impressed. Lastly, Mohamed Sanu, 12 targets, 9 receptions. Basically, you know, Tennessee was coming in here. They were trying to shut down Calvin Ridley and Julio Jones, and so Atlanta was taking what they were given. 18 receptions between Hooper and Sanu, but no touchdowns. Now, on the running game, you know it was going to be a tough sledding for because they don't ever use Devontae Freeman anyway, but Devontae Freeman went 12 attempts, 28 yards, 2.3 yards per carry. Now, normally, Freeman will get more yards per carry, but again, this is a tough Tennessee defense. They come into Atlanta. They shut down a pass-first offense. I like them, man. I like the Tennessee Titans. Respect to the Tennessee Titans. Now, let's talk about them a little bit. First, Mariota's stats. 27 attempts, 18 completions, not that great. 3 touchdowns. That's very good. Mariota, I didn't think that he was going to be able to really get the passing game going, but he got 3 touchdowns. Now, one of those was, at least one of those was to A.J. Brown, who actually just kind of sprung that short passing attack and took it long. Brown ended up with 3 catches, 94 yards, and 2 touchdowns. Corey Davis finally got in the end zone, 5 receptions, 91 yards, and a touchdown. So they were just working. Atlanta's defense is going to struggle for the rest of the year. When Neal went out, I mean, it happened last season too. They need that guy in the lineup. They were already struggling, but without him, they're a ship without a captain, man. It's going to be tough sledding for Atlanta all season long. Tennessee had no problem putting up 24 points on this defense. I think better offenses, more refined offenses with more refined quarterbacks are going to score a lot against Atlanta. It's going to be a tough one. Derrick Henry, 27 attempts, 100 yards. You know, of course, Atlanta was going to come in there trying to stop Henry, but he still got his 100 yards. Yes, only 3.7 yards per carry, but when Mariota throws for 3 touchdowns, that's all you need. I will say this too, Delanie Walker only had 2 targets for 1 attempt. So again, game plan wise, you could see Atlanta was trying to take away the 2 big weapons, the weapons that I've been talking about on this show as well, Walker and Henry. Henry still got his, Delanie Walker didn't, but the receivers, those very, very talented receivers, by the way, Corey Davis and A.J. Brown did very, very well. I'd like to see Mariota and Tennessee continue to involve these receivers, but I do think it's game plan specific, and they will continue to lean on Derrick Henry, which I think is the right thing to do. From a fantasy football perspective, I think this is all matchup based. You know, Corey Davis, I do think, should be rostered. I'm a little hot and cold on Brown. I don't think he's the greatest guy to own, but I do think matchup-wise, he'll be able to stick it in the end zone every couple of weeks, as we've seen so far this season. I still think Delanie Walker is the guy you want in this passing attack. He will be the most consistent, but Atlanta came in trying to stop Delanie Walker, and they made him pay elsewhere. Tennessee, that's a balanced team. They can take what the defense gives them. They're going to be tough, man. That whole AFC South, I think they're all 2-2, and they're all very good, and they all play sound football. There's no reason Tennessee can't win this division. I've come around on them. I was a little bit down on them coming into the season, but they play a nice brand of football, and you got to respect that. So there you go. Atlanta side, if Hooper still is by any chance available in your fantasy league, got to snap him up. He's a long-term, week-long, and week-to-week, every week you can play this guy and start him. Even if you can flex out a tight end in your league, I mean, I suggest he's getting over 100 yards every week. If he was a wide receiver, you'd be playing him every week. So you got to do that. If you can flex out that tight end, or if you need a tight end and he's available, snap him up. But that's about it. Otherwise, you're playing matchups. So check out our weekly preview stuff. We do some daily fantasy and fantasy analytics. You might be more interested in that. If you could also please subscribe to our channel, check out some more videos. That's how we grow. We're trying to get to our watch hours so that we can get our official YouTube partnership status. We need your help doing that. Subscribe to our videos, watch some of our playlists. It's all free, and we release a lot of good fantasy football content, so check us out in the future. Thanks. Catch you on another episode.